Okay. To sleep is disrespected. In Greek mythology, as the legendary New York hip-hop artist Nas alludes to in this quote, the god of sleep Hypnos and the god of death Thanatos were actually, in fact, related. They were twins. We often dismiss sleep as being something that happens in the absence of activity rather than an activity in and of itself. And despite spending a third of our entire lives sleeping, you often hear phrases like, I'll sleep when I'm dead, or when faced with difficult decisions, you often hear things like, I'll sleep on it, as if we're able to do anything other than sleep when we're asleep. In this day and age of screens everywhere, we're doom scrolling at night in bed, waking up tired, and in general, disrespecting sleep. And today, we're going to talk about how shift work impacts our lives, how we can live better with shift work. We'll be talking not only about sleep, but also about food and a few other tricks to improve your quality of life. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Yusang. I'm one of the third-year emergency medicine residents. I am a father of twin daughters, and therefore I have no financial interests, only expenses. I have no sponsors. Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So you've all seen this before. And among all of our needs, we often spend grand rounds discussing those at the highest level. Today, things are going to be a little more grounded. We'll briefly touch upon how things like performance and how things like safety are affected by shift work, sure. But let me be clear, this is not a performance talk. This is not a wellness talk. This is very much a survival talk. Today, I want you to think about the most basic needs that we have in terms of survival in the context of shift work. I'm most interested in food, in sleep, and in not dying. And I'm sure many of you are too. And so that's what we'll be spending most of our time on today. And just to give you a better idea of how basic and important these issues are, they're on the same level as excretion. And if you can't do that properly, well, I don't think Rosen's questions or academic projects or career trajectory, you know, are these things are the least of your concern. In fact, these are key skills that are actually required by the Royal College within the CanMeds framework. As a professional, physicians must be able to manage personal well-being for the sake of professional performance. And if you're still not convinced, if for nothing other than hireability and finding a job, you can think of it this way. Would you want to hire somebody who cannot demonstrate that they're capable of taking care of themselves? If I was the one doing the hiring, that's something that I'd actually be asking during the interview. How do you cope with shift work? And I think the inability to answer this question in a well-articulated manner would demonstrate to me paucity of thought, lack of maturity, and the unwillingness to experiment. And so, what is shift work anyway? Well, it's defined as any work performed outside of typical daytime hours. So evening shifts, overnight shifts, flex time, basically anything that's not a 9-to-5. In 2011, 1.8 million Canadians, or 12% of the working population, were exposed to night shift, with 45% being female. The highest prevalence by occupation at number one was protective services like fire and police at 37%. A close number two were healthcare workers such as ourselves at 35%. And then after that, manufacturing at about 24%. But when considering not just night shifts, but all shift workers, numbers go as high as 28%. So over a quarter of the working population. So clearly, a lot of people are doing shift work. But what does shift work mean for the people who do it? Well, in Canada, as in the rest of the world, pretty much all the implications are negative. And they can be summarized into the problems that occur on economic, social, and health levels. From an economics perspective, there are very specific costs that are associated with shift work that you don't see elsewhere. A great example is absenteeism. A study looking at police officers who call in sick found that shift work, in and of itself, is independently associated with sickness absence. And officers who worked the night shift in particular had the highest incidence of calling in sick. This sounded kind of familiar with regards to our off-service residents and our night shifts. There's work-related accidents and injuries, which are obviously very costly. The cost associated with insuring for these accidents and injuries, retraining new employees due to higher turnover rates compared to daytime working population. So all these factors contribute to the economic costs and implications of shift work. On a social level, well, quite simply, it's hard to be social when you're working a lot of evenings and nights. It's harder to meet friends, harder to spend time with your children, with your family. And so not surprisingly, Shift workers are twice as likely to be divorced, and they're also much more likely to be engaged in substance abuse. And of course, we've all heard of the health risks involved with shift work, from everything metabolic to MVCs to depression, but even infertility and immune dysfunction. There have been numerous studies linking shift work to an increased risk of certain forms of cancer, like breast, prostate, colorectal. So much so that in 2007, the International Agency for Research on Cancer classified shift work as a group 2A carcinogen. This puts shift work in the same category as lead, insecticides, and UV radiation. So based on this, Cancer Care Ontario acknowledged in 2011 that shift work in Canadian industries is a probable carcinogen. And the list is growing. Every year, there's new research showing new associations. Just last year, a study out of Korea comparing shift versus day working nurses found that shift working nurses, other than reporting the expected sleep disturbance and depressive symptoms, actually showed reduced gray matter volume on brain MRI. So shift work may quite literally be shrinking your brain. In fact, working too much at odd hours can literally kill you. Sudden death from working too much into the night in Japan is known as karoshi. And there is legal precedent there for considering night shift a compensable cause for premature death. So when you put everything together, the implications for shift work are enormous. But to take things one step even further, we should be asking ourselves, why is this particularly important to us as emergency physicians? Well, this is me. Circa 2012-13 as an OR intern with the cardiac transplant team at Korea University. This is after a 12-hour transplant surgery that ended at 7 a.m. And this is a photograph taken by the attending, the lead surgeon. And this is the day that I definitively decided I would never become a surgeon. Smith Coggins and colleagues had a study published in the Journal of Emergency Medicine that evaluated shift work perspectives. They surveyed more than 1,000 U.S. eMERGE physicians. And they found that 58% responded that that night shift work negatively influenced job satisfaction. That 43% indicated that night shift had caused them to think about leaving emergency medicine. And perhaps most alarmingly, among those who had already left emergency medicine as a profession, 56% said that late evenings and night shift were a major factor in their decision to leave. So much like how that terrible rotation made me feel exhausted and never want to be a surgeon, shift work is a huge factor in emergency physician turnover. We have to learn to effectively deal with shift work to survive, but also to thrive and avoid looking like the guy in this photo here on a regular basis. The take-home message from this segment is that shift work has real implications, and that no matter where you are, how far along you are in your career in emergency medicine, never too late to try to be better at it for yourselves, for your patients, and for those around you. So let's talk about sleep first. We'll be talking about sleep in the context of the schedule that's most disruptive to sleep, so the night shift. I received over 100 responses to my survey, so thank you to all those who responded. In terms of what kind of sleep pattern or chronotype people fall in, majority of respondents, unsurprisingly, were intermediate types between early morning folks and night owls. There was also a larger proportion of night owls than the general population, which is, again, unsurprising considering what we do for a living. But then there were the really interesting answers filed under other. People actually took the time to tell me that they were a drowsy duckling, wakes up at dawn to begin ferreting its flock, but can also be seen after sundown, has the uncanny ability to fall asleep nearly anywhere, including standing up. That sounded a lot like me, so I identify with you, whoever you are. But also sloth, likes to sleep in, works well between lunch and dinner, and goes to bed early. That person is quite literally living the dream. So let's first talk about how things tend to get set up before a night shift. We've all been there before. You're about to start a string of three nights. You already have a lot of things going on with your life. You haven't even worked one yet, and you're already exhausted. You're laying in bed, you want to sleep. The only thought that keeps going through your mind is, if I don't sleep now, I'm only going to get 4 hours of sleep. If I don't sleep now, I'm only going to get 2 hours of sleep. So what do you do? Of course, you get out your phone. Bad move. you know this is a bad move because somewhere in the distant past, you've heard of something called sleep hygiene. And this is pretty basic. Michael Jordan didn't become the greatest of all time by practicing insane windmill dunks or crazy half-court three-pointers all the time. He became the best by sticking to fundamentals. And sleep hygiene is the most basic, but I'd also say often the most neglected aspect of effective sleep. So just to quickly review, sleep hygiene means making your bedroom quiet, dark, comfortable temperature, removing all electronic devices, so no work in bed, avoiding large meals, caffeine, alcohol before bedtime, regular exercise, but not close to bedtime. And for sure, you know, these are fundamentals and a great place to start. But even under ideal sleep hygiene conditions, it's not always easy to fall asleep. So how do people in the worst possible conditions do it? Well, the U.S. Naval Pre-Flight School has been training its pilots to sleep under terrible conditions in cold winter. They have a program that was extremely effective at getting their pilots to fall asleep in under 2 minutes, even with coffee, even with the sound of simulated machine gun fire in the background. So in the training, the pilots were taught to fall asleep while sitting upright in a chair. Not ideal, for sure, but the thought was, you can fall asleep upright in a chair, you can fall asleep pretty much anywhere. So they would put their feet flat on the floor, they would let their hands go limp against their laps, and they would say that your face is the key to slowing down everything. Think of it as the epicenter of your emotions. You relax all your face muscles, no squinting, no frowning. And when you relax your face, you signal to the rest of your body it's time to unwind. Now it becomes all about your shoulders, let them drop as low as you can. You should feel the back of your neck go lifeless. Next are your arms, you start with the dominant side, you feel it relax, drop down your body, and the forearm, and the hand, and the fingers, then the opposite arm. Next stop is the legs. The last stop is to clear your mind for at least 10 seconds. You know, thinking about what went wrong that day or what time you need to get up. And there are many ways to clear your head. Traditional meditation would have you focus on your breath. Alternatively, you could hold an image of yourself somewhere, like on a beach. And if that doesn't work, you could try saying to yourself, don't think, kind of like a mantra over and over again, until that's all you can think of. And that's it. It seems simple, but it takes practice. A lot of practice. In fact, it takes at least 6 weeks. By the end of 6 weeks, though, of practicing daily, 96% of these pilots were able to fall asleep consistently in under 2 minutes. The point I'm trying to make here is that sleeping is a skill. It can be improved with discipline and with practice. But that last step, trying to think of nothing, that's often the hardest part of falling asleep, isn't it? There are a number of apps out there designed around mindfulness to help its users practice meditation, deep breathing, relaxation, wellness. And most of these apps feature a sleep component. These are either exercises, stories, or sounds to help you fall asleep. And I've used some of these apps to great effect in the past, and I'd recommend everybody give them a shot. One of the most popular and the most studied is an app called Calm. According to a recent cross-sectional survey, 90% of its users have difficulties with sleep, and 77% of them started using the app primarily for sleep. So you wouldn't be alone. And you wouldn't be wrong to try either. According to an RCT run out of Arizona State, 10 minutes a day for 8 weeks is all it took to get significant improvements in sleep quality. A cross-sectional survey run by the same group found that the majority of respondents reported using Calm helped them fall asleep, stay asleep, and get more restful sleep. So, you know, these are relatively cheap, low-commitment interventions that may seem like mumbo-jumbo voodoo magic at first, but they're proven to work both through modern scientific research, but also based on hundreds of years behind the history of meditation. So you got a few hours of sleep, you went into your night shift, it's 6:30 a.m. now, you're at the tail end of the shift. You're rushing to tie up loose ends, maybe see that one last patient, preparing for handover. This is the last year string of nights, you're about to start like a 10-day vacation. You're so close to freedom that you can practically taste it. However, compared to everything that you've done in the last 12 hours, the next 2 hours are probably the most dangerous for your health and safety. A landmark study in Nature in 1997 showed how fatigue could cause just as much impairment as alcohol use. The study took 40 subjects, split them into two groups. One was kept awake for 28 hours, The other group consumed alcohol every 30 minutes until their blood alcohol concentration was 0.1%. Pretty clear which group I'd want to be a part of. The results showed that after only 17 hours of sustained wakefulness, cognitive and psychomotor performance decreased to a level equivalent to that of the legal limit here in Ontario, which is 0.05%. Multiple other studies have replicated these findings. The effects of 0.05 blood alcohol concentration should probably be unfortunately familiar to anybody who's worked in that shift before. This study by Lee and colleagues is from the University of Texas and was published in 2016. This is the first of its kind. It studied the impact of a night shift work on measures of drowsiness and driving performance while operating a real motor vehicle. So this was done on a closed track. Of the 16 post-sleep drives, there were zero near crashes or early drive termination. And of the 16 post-night shift drives, cumulatively, 7 of 16 were terminated early for safety reasons. So the authors concluded what we all already intuitively know, which is that night shift work increases driver drowsiness, degrades driving performance, and increases the risk of near crash drive events. And this risk is not theoretical. A cross-sectional survey from just last year, 2021, of 273 residents out of BC doing shift work found that 66% felt their safety was impaired as a result of fatigue while driving. And shockingly, 54% of these residents reported at least one MVC in the last year. Every additional 10 kilometers of travel time equated to an adjusted OR of 1.54 increased risk of MVC on the way home. What does that mean for somebody like me who lives 30 kilometers away from the Civic and even further away from the General? That got me thinking, well, if shift work is unavoidable and we know it's unsafe, well, what can we do about this? At 2017, RCT used bright light therapy to see if it could specifically improve safety in sleep-deprived subjects. So at the tail end of a simulated night shift, relatively dark environments, just like RED, one group was exposed to dim light and another to bright light for 45 minutes each. Both groups then completed a simulated driving test, and the authors found significantly decreased rates of MVCs in the bright light group. Bright light is cheap, safe, and it seems to work for driving safety after a night shift. But also, bright lights can also help with performance while still on shift. Bright lights at night significantly increase subjective alertness and cognitive performance in shift workers. This has been demonstrated in numerous studies going back at least 3 decades, starting with a landmark study in 1990 in EJ. In fact, the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, where Homer Simpson works, has even implemented bright lights at night for its shift workers and has found less fatigue, better alertness on the job. This is why casinos look the way they do. All night, every night. And we can certainly take a page out of their playbooks because there's an opportunity here for us to do better. I think we should be keeping the nursing and physician work areas as bright as possible overnight to help with better performance. Patient areas can remain dark, but the workstations should have tons of light. And also, I think morning handover is a great opportunity and location to have bright lights to, number one, improve the safety of the going home team. But with the added benefit of number two, helping transition day team workers, especially those who are not of the early morning chronotype, into wakefulness. And yes, for sure, you know, there are nuances to discuss here. You know, to promote better sleep at home, I'm sure you've heard of avoiding sunlight and driving home with your sunglasses on. And a lot of studies have recommended this for sure. But I'd argue that getting home alive in one piece is probably, you know, to complain about not getting enough sleep is preferable to sleeping permanently. So the solution that I'd recommend is still bright lights at work, but then transitioning to dark on the way home once you're within a reasonably safe distance to do so. The takeaway here from the sleep section, I'd say, is that number one, sleep is a skill that can be perfected. It's something that we can be better at. And number two, driving home after nights is dangerous. And bright lights, which are cheap, pretty effective, can be used to optimize performance overnight and safety after night shifts as well. So now let's talk about food, my favorite pastime. We'll talk a little bit about the psychological foundations behind why we eat the way we do as well first. And, you know, I'm sure you've all heard this before, you are what you eat. And this is true in a number of ways. Specifically today, it's true in that what you eat can change the way you feel. And how you feel can change the way you perform. A study in Brazil looked at the dietary patterns of shift-working truck drivers by shift and assessed their sleeping. And they were able to categorize these truck drivers into essentially three different kinds of eating categories. The healthy slash prudent diet group, predictably, reported less sleepiness and therefore felt safer on the job. So, you know, nothing really groundbreaking there. Eating healthy is good for performance. Anybody who's tried to go to the gym after a Big Mac could have told you that. But what about eating late at night? Isn't that bad for you, like always? Well, it can be. It's complicated, but there's a ton of research on this. Essentially, eating late at night causes altered hormone dysfunction, specifically insulin, glucagon, and leptin, which leads to decreased blood sugar control, risk of diabetes and obesity. And also lipid metabolism is very reliant on the circadian rhythm. And thus nighttime eating has been linked to elevated triglycerides and cholesterol. So very much like a metabolic syndrome type picture. Also, when people eat more in the evening, they have higher markers of inflammation. One study found that for each 10% increase in caloric intake between 5 p.m. and midnight, there was a 3% rise in serum CRP levels. Chronic inflammation, as I'm sure you've heard before, associated with autoimmune diseases, metabolic diseases, various forms of cancer. So we know the timing of when we eat and the content of what we eat are both important. So how do we optimize our food intake for best performance and for best health while we're doing shift work? Well, I think we'd all agree that on day shifts and on evening shifts, which overlap with traditional meal times, it's probably wise to have something to eat while you're working, even a full meal. It helps you think, helps your mood, better for your patient. Overnight is a bit trickier. A study in 2017 examined whether meal timing for shift working nurses had an impact on cardiometabolic syndrome indicators. Depressingly, they found that regardless of what was actually eaten overnight, increase in any food consumption was associated with increased lipid level. Conversely, daytime intake of several different foods was associated with higher HDL levels, the good cholesterol. So does this mean that we can't eat anything at all overnight? I think the takeaway here is that even with shift work, what you want to do is you want to keep your meals as close to usual circadian rhythm as possible. So here's what I mean. Here's your typical day shift schedule. There are three square meals, breakfast, lunch, and dinner at regularly spaced intervals. Pretty simple. The way you work your meals into routine on night shifts is still to try to keep them as close to usual timing as possible. Dinner as a meal probably happened later than usual timing before you go into work. Breakfast is going to be really light and after your night shift, since you're probably going to bed soon after. And lunch is after you've woken up for your morning sleep, giving you plenty of time to digest before getting your second nap before your second night shift. The key here, again, is to try to keep your meals within more or less a similar window during nights as you do during days to avoid upsetting the circadian rhythm and keeping the cholesterol level nice and low. That's the timing of meals. Then what should we be doing with night shifts? Well, a 2019 study from Australia attempted to determine how to optimize both the timing and the content of food for performance overnight. They got a sample of 40 participants and randomized them to meal, snack, or no food, and put them through simulated driving shifts overnight. They found that the snack group showed increased time spent in the safe driving zone, better reaction times, and better memory scores when compared with both the full meal group and the no food group. So the authors concluded that number one, eating a large meal overnight impairs cognitive performance and sleepiness above the effects of time of night alone. But number two, they furthermore recommended that for improved performance, shift workers should opt for a snack at night. We work a very, you know, high stakes job. So I think, you know, the next time you're working nights, try taking a break, try having a small snack. Definitely avoid like the fatty, fried, spicy, sugary foods. These contribute to the metabolic syndrome picture, bloating, heartburn, farting. You want to go for high energy, low glycemic index foods. We're talking soups, nuts and seeds, low sugar protein bars, yogurts are great examples. The importance of hydration overnight also cannot be overstated. So you can kill two birds with one stone with healthy snacks plus hydration with hydrating foods like watermelon, strawberries, and cucumbers. For the sake of time, personally, I like the vegetable slash strawberry smoothie made at home plus protein bar approach around 3:30 a.m. My survey showed that most of us are already having a snack on nights, which is great. But again, the key here isn't that there's one single approach that's definitively superior than another in terms of like timing or what it is you're eating. The key is that you owe it to yourself and to your patients to continue to try different things to find what works best. It's pretty clear that if you're appropriately watered and fed, you'll be less sleepy, you'll perform better overnight. But what I find even more interesting, however, is the converse, which is that how we feel often determines how and what we eat. So I want you to picture this scene with me. You just finished a rough op shift at the general, an evening shift. It's Friday night. It's now 1:30 a.m. Because you stuck around to help dispo that one last patient who found out you hadn't charted on another, so on and so forth. You finally leave the emerge by 2 a.m. You just had dinner a few hours ago, but somehow you're starving again. You changed, you find your car, and now you're driving home. But you know what's waiting for you at home in the fridge. Nothing. Nothing but sadness. You turn the car onto CarLink, and you see the golden arches. It's difficult to look away now. You already made eye contact, and you could swear those arches are looking right back at you. You give in. A quick snack, you tell yourself. You place your order. You can barely make eye contact with the traffic worker, who, by the way, is also working shift work. You think, I'm sure they understand. But you wonder if they're judging. The shame is real. The guilt is palpable. This quick snack turns into an all-out feast, and now it's 3 a.m. You feel gross, and you can't sleep because you're too full. You're full of fast food, but you're also full of regret. And that, my friends, is how your mood controls food, but also how your food can control your mood. A study from 2019 in Australia looked at what factors were associated with shift working nurses' diets. Like the very real story I just told you, they found that higher levels of stress are associated with a higher level of energy intake and a higher percentage of fat and saturated fat intake. So what they concluded was dietary interventions for shift workers should consider the role of mood as well as shift type. And I think this is an extremely important point to highlight that we often gloss over. We know that after a challenging evening shift in recess, we're going to be tired and cranky. We know that it's going to be difficult to turn down a sugar high or a saturated fat rush afterwards. And aside from being incredibly, unbelievably motivated, the only countermeasure against this is planning. The way to beat fast food and cheap unhealthy eats is preparation. You must win the war on convenience, but also satisfaction. And just like sleep, this takes practice. You can't just become like an efficient and talented chef just overnight. Not everybody has the time to meal prep for the week with fresh fruits and vegetables. You can certainly get better and faster at it with time and practice, but if you're like me, you often just can't be bothered to prep and cook, and I don't blame you. There are many options out there, however, to save you time and grief. Ottawa Meal Prep and Meal Pro, for example, are many that are available in Ottawa. They pre-cook meals, they deliver them to your house, you refrigerate them, you freeze them, you eat them when you want. They're all macronutrient balanced with different options depending on what your fitness goals are. If you have no fitness goals, they have meals for that too. I've used a few of these before and they're quite effective, cutting out a lot of the junk in my diet. You bring them to eat on shift, you can use them as a deterrent to picking up unhealthy foods on the way home. And yes, that they come at the expense of money. But whatever money you spend now will be saved later when you don't have to pay out of pocket for rehab from your stroke at 45 from recurrent intractable Burger King after 19. The takeaway here is that understanding the why, the when behind our eating patterns can help us plan for mitigation effectively. And everybody is different. You should try experimenting with different strategies, including snacking overnight, those meal prep plans, to find what works for you. Now that food and sleep are out of the way, there's a few other tools at your disposal for coping with shift work. And we'll go in order of accessibility. So we'll start with caffeine. And the big question with caffeine has always been, is caffeine effective? We drink it all the time to make us more alert. The psychology literature is full of small-scale trials examining the effects of caffeine on cognition. But all of these, most of these, are measured by paper and pencil tests. Caffeine seems to facilitate learning. Caffeine appears to improve memory, seems to improve reaction time. The question is it useful in real life? This Cochrane review in 2010 attempted to assess the effects of caffeine on preventing injuries caused by impaired alertness in shift workers. And the pooled effect estimates on performance suggested that compared to placebo, caffeine improved concept formation, reasoning, memory, orientation, attention, and perception. So overall, caffeine intake may be beneficial in our line of work, plus safety. But we don't actually know that it improves safety. So despite the title of the Cochrane review, none of those studies actually measured an injury outcome. And furthermore, you know, going back to the theme of driving home safely for a moment, if you remember, like, you know, sleepiness equals pretty much alcohol in terms of driving safety. This study actually tested their subjects both before and after coffee ingestion and found that coffee was not an effective countermeasure for sleep impaired driving. Furthermore, they found that the driver's ability to judge their own impairment was very limited, so very much like alcohol. So drinking coffee while you're tired does not make you safer. A study in 2003 from the Journal of Biological Rhythms found that bright light, scheduled dark, sunglasses, and melatonin, when all used together, were very useful in manipulating circadian rhythm for night shift. You've all heard of everything else so far. What is melatonin? Well, it's a sleep hormone secreted by the pineal gland. Or is it pineal gland? More melatonin equals more sleepy. In a typical daytime shift pattern, melatonin release begins around 8 p.m., peaks around 3 a.m. So the peak lasts between 3 a.m. and 5 a.m., which is why, you know, if you work night shifts, you know the hours between 3 and 5 are the witching hours. They're terrible. By 7 a.m., your melatonin levels have dropped significantly, and they're further inhibited by bright light exposure, hence sunglasses, hence difficult to fall asleep for night shift workers. Interestingly, melatonin decreases with age, which partly explains why your grandparents are up at 4 in the morning every day, and also why teenagers seem to be able to sleep until the afternoon every day and then get blamed. They get called lazy, when in fact it's just their melatonin. There are a lot of studies out there surrounding melatonin and its use in terms of insomnia and shift work. And some of the older trials were negative, but overall, there are modest benefits that are definitely worth exploring. A 2013 meta-analysis showed that melatonin helped fall asleep faster, increased total sleep time, improved overall sleep quality, and had a very favorable side effect profile. More relevant to us, the shift workers, another meta-analysis found that after a night shift, melatonin was associated with increased daytime sleep duration. You can use melatonin in three different ways. You can use it before a string of night shifts, in the afternoon to help you flip into the night rhythm. You can use it after your first or second night shift while you're still doing night shifts to help you sleep longer during the day, as evidence has proven. And you can also, number three, use it after you're done with your string of nights to help you flip back into the daytime rhythm. It's been proven to help with insomnia. You know, the effects are modest though, to be sure. The time required to fall asleep, or what's known as sleep latency, improved by an average of 7 minutes. Before you dismiss 7 minutes, doesn't sound like much on the surface for sure, but considering the average sleep latency is 10 to 20 minutes, 7 minutes is pretty significant. Total sleep time increased by about 8 to 24 minutes, depending on the trial. So overall, the effects are modest to be sure, but the harm is minimal. And I think one of the main reasons many of us haven't either tried melatonin yet or don't use it regularly is that we worry about, number one, side effects like drowsiness after waking up, or number two, dependence, and nobody wants to be an addict. Reassuringly, all the meta-analyses showed no dose response association, effects did not appear to fade with the continued use over time. So there was no habituation, and there were extremely, extremely low side effects. So it's really pretty safe, but we think of it as a drug. But what if I showed it to you like this? The purple chewable gummy here is 3 milligrams of melatonin each. So well within the 1 to 10 milligram dosing found in all of the shift worker studies. It's safe, it's not addictive, it's over the counter, it's cheap. As my sassy grandma always used to say, don't knock it till you try. In fact, I have an extra pack of melatonin here that came as a 2-for-1 deal. If you want to try it, we can share. I'll give it to you. It's worked for me. And the last of the tools in my magic bag of tricks today is scheduling. And a lot of us are very interested in scheduling in the sense that, you know, it impacts our lives directly. But it's also the least accessible of the tools because we don't have much control over the systems that are set and not all of our requests can be accommodated for practical reasons. But having said that, even if you have no interest in the black magic that is scheduling, there are some basic scheduling concepts here that I'm certain will help you. I'm hoping to help you understand why your schedule looks the way it does, so you can take full advantage of it by being able to plan activity and sleep around it. So historically, the circadian gold standard for scheduling has been to work the same shift all the time. Here's a 9-to-5 job, Monday to Friday, with the weekend off, pretty simple. But we don't have just day shifts. We have evenings and we have nights. So the way that we switch between them is to move forward, or we go in what's known as a clockwise shift rotation from days to evenings and then to nights, typically. The principle behind this, and I'm sure most of you would agree, is that it's way easier to stay up later and delay sleep than it is to try and fall asleep earlier. One study by the Philadelphia Police Force in 1988 showed what happened when they changed their rotation direction from counterclockwise to clockwise. This resulted in improvements in total sleep time, fatigue level, safety, sleeping pill use, alcohol use, and family satisfaction rate. So since the 1980s, there's pretty much no industry that goes counterclockwise anymore for these kinds of reasons. And this is what we try to do here at TOH. I'm sure everybody has noticed in their schedule, typically things tend to move forward from days to evenings to nights. And one of the simplest schedule rotations that incorporates the clockwise rotation concept is known as the continental schedule. You are constantly moving forwards in your schedule, either 2 or 3 shifts at a time, and then you usually get a 3-to-4 day break at the end of your rotation. Again, kind of looks similar to most of our schedules. When it comes to night shifts, there's something called a rapid night rotation scheme, which incorporates short runs of nights, hence the term rapid, into a continental scheme. It quickly lets you dip your feet in and out of the overnight life 1-to-2 shifts at a time, which keeps your circadian rhythm in a daytime rhythm relatively. And most people seem to prefer this. And this is practiced here, again, at TOH. The likely reason that we keep this as a rapid rotation and don't do more than like 4 or 5 in a row is because there's good evidence against that. A study in the Annals of Emergency Medicine compared cognitive functioning between 16 eMERGE residents on days versus nights. They tested half while working days, the other half while working nights for 2 months, and then switched for another 2 months. They found that every physician but one had significant decline in cognitive performance after working 5 consecutive night shifts. The Thomas schedule is a bit of the opposite approach in the sense that it's not a rapid rotation, this is a very slow rotation. Rather than keeping the schedule diurnal, its focus is to flip to a nighttime or nocturnal. This is based on the principle that it takes about 7 days for the circadian rhythm to switch completely from day to night. So it's kind of like the jet lag you experience when you travel across the other side of the globe. This may look like terrible on the surface, and yes, you do like a 3 or 4 week rotation of only nights with quick breaks in between, but then you do no night shifts for an entire year. So the goal here is to have a long run of night shifts where the individual stays nocturnal rhythm, and then also avoids more than 5 night shifts in a row. This has been shown to have greater sleep length at home, less sleepiness on the job, better self-reported performance, and fewer errors. The most common point of failure are those 2-day breaks, where people tend to revert back to like a daytime rhythm, and the worker, worst case scenario, has to reset their nocturnal rhythm every single week, which is exhausting. And how about casino shifts? Controversial. Some people love them, some people hate them. Some people seem to love one, but not the other. With casino shifts, one long night shift is cut into two shorter shifts, 10 p.m. to 4 a.m., 4 a.m. to 10 a.m. This helps schedule different chronotypes, since the early risers can take the 4 a.m. shift, the night owls can take the 10 p.m. shift. Both these groups can then continue their next day relatively normally without affecting their social lives, needing to reset their day-night cycle. That's the theory. A survey of 15 physicians at Dartmouth General in Nova Scotia found that after 2 years, the ED physicians preferred the casino shift, their families preferred it, they slept 25% more, recovery time was shorter, the perceived cognitive impairment over the last 4 hours of each shift was significantly less when compared with a regular night shift. So this is probably because casino shifts are based upon the concept of something called anchor sleep, which, as its name implies, is supposed to keep you anchored in a single circadian rhythm, regardless of which shift, which of those two shifts you're working. This concept was first described in the 70s. And basically, anchor sleep is a period of at least 4 hours during which one sleeps every day while on a particular shift rotation. And it's the same 4 hours every day. So here's what I mean. Let's say you just worked a string of night shifts. You were up until 8 a.m. And then you slept from 8 a.m. till 4 p.m. You up from 4 p.m. until 9 p.m. eating dinner, playing video games. And then since you were tired, you fell back asleep at around 10 p.m. The next day you head off, but you know, let's say maybe you typically have some difficulty slipping back into daytime rhythm. And so you woke up around midnight. You played some video games again, and then you were up until 4 a.m. And then from 4 a.m. to noon, you were able to sleep again. In our example, this overlapping interval from 8 a.m. to noon of these 4 hours is your anchor sleep. Your body's circadian rhythm becomes very attuned to sleeping specifically during these times. And theoretically, you are much more functional and alert because of it. And for many, many years, casinos around the world appear to have accomplished rotating through both day shifts and night shifts, yet keeping the same circadian clock, a shift changing at 0400 hours. But with 1.8 million Canadians working nights, why doesn't every industry use this format? Well, for one, the theory around anchor sleep is just that, theory. There's no studies yet that show that anchor sleep actually anchors your circadian rhythm. Also, so there's very little research in the way of casino shifts, but a 2019 study looked into pediatric emergency medicine residents' perceptions towards casino shifts at Western University. They found no difference in self-reported wellness between the residents working casinos versus traditional. But despite all this, the scheduling flexibility, the additional coverage options, along with the fact that different chronotypes can be scheduled differently, mean that casino shifts offer very unique advantages that can be exploited. And this is why many EDs across Canada use casino shifts. If you know your chronotype to be a super early riser, you should be asking your scheduler for more 4 a.m. shifts instead of overnight, for example. If you're an absolute night owl, you can opt for the 10 p.m. shift. And if you're the dolphin chronotype, who just never sleeps, much like our fearless leader, you can work pretty much whenever you want. And there are 100 more variations in scheduling. There's the Fast 12, which sounds like a Vin Diesel movie. There's the Panama, which is used by Secret Service agents, and so on and so forth. The takeaway here is that scheduling is not something that you can always control, but understanding it can help you take advantage of it and effectively plan around it. Caffeine can help you be more alert on the job, but does not necessarily make you safer. That melatonin is moderately effective, but very safe, and thus definitely worth trying out. So as we get closer to the end of today's talk, I want you to think back to Maslow's pyramid of needs. Food and sleep are on the same level as breathing and peeing. These are quite literally the foundation to everything else. And if you can't do these things well, it's hard to imagine doing anything above that well either. Remember, about half of eMERGE docs say that night shift makes them think about leaving emergency medicine. And so this is the money slide. If you were going to screenshot one slide today, it would be this one. I want you to pick two things here that you're going to commit to trying for at least the next 8 weeks. I want you to start viewing sleep as a skill, to try practicing it and getting better at it. Optimize your sleep hygiene. If you have trouble falling asleep, try one of the meditation apps. If you do, I will sponsor your first month. Try melatonin to flip into a rhythm or help you stay in a rhythm. Like I said, I have extra. I am willing to share. Be mindful of why you're eating what you're eating. See if a trial subscription to one of those healthy meal prep services helps you. If you haven't already, try snacking overnight. Try eating different things at different times to find what works best for you during night shifts. Because maybe the most important takeaway from today is that we're all different, but that you owe it to yourself, your patients, and your loved ones to find what works for you. Residency and academic emerge physician life isn't just about research and roses. It's also about rest and relaxation. And I don't mean rest and relaxation simply as an absence of work or study, but rather as skill sets that must be developed and honed over the course of many, many years, well into staffhood. So I want you and myself to be the person on the left here and not the corpse on the right. Pick it from somebody who's doing residency for a second time with twins during a pandemic. If you don't take good care of yourself and learn how to do this, nobody else will. Thank you for your time and for your attention today. Remember to smash the like and subscribe button and hit the notification bell for future updates. If you have any comments or questions, let's talk about it.